Now we are coming close to a period of the early 70s, which is logical in this context, because it is in 71 or 72 that I became aware, through Herbert Curran, of the fact that at the same time as I, totally separately, totally independent of me, a number of physicists have been studying a phenomenon called as critical fluctuations, and using tools which, for some extraordinary coincidence, were very much the same as those I've been using. Now, what is critical opalescence? It's rather important and easy to say. If you have a tube with liquid and gas above it, as you heat them, at one point the bond between liquid and gas vanishes, and the liquid becomes the fluid becomes quite opaque, which is why opalescence. When you heat even further, it is neither a gas nor a liquid, it's something else, and again it is transparent. It's a phenomenon which struck imagination in 19th century and was very much discussed in books of science for the young people or science for amateur that I was reading as a young man, as a child. Critical opalescence was discovered, therefore, at that time. Sometime later, Pierre Curie, a very great scientist, discovered that if you heat a magnet enough above a certain temperature, it ceases to be a magnet. And that temperature is called the critical temperature or the Curie temperature. And in more generally, many phenomena in physics have different phases, and at certain under certain critical conditions, the character changes. A breakthrough in that context was in 1944 an extraordinary calculation performed by Lars Onsager, nominally a chemist, but in the book of many of my friends, one of the great mathematicians of this century, who succeeded in solving the problem of the Ising model in two dimensions. That is, you imagine that a big magnet is made of a gigantic collection of small magnets which can be up and down, that only neighbours interact and not beyond neighbours. Interaction is very, very short range. That these magnets are being hit by an environment which is at some temperature. So the higher temperature, the strongest the inversions of these magnets forced by the environment. And the question arises, is it possible for these small magnets acting together to create gross, visible, macroscopic magnetism? And Onsager solved this problem in two dimensions. In three dimensions, it's gigantic, no more complicated. Now, Onsager did that in 44. From what I understand, for the next 20 years, his ideas were very, very slowly digested. And around 65, or shortly before, the study of critical phenomena became again extremely active and produced several great scientists who established a very, very great chapter of physics around them, based again upon scaling, upon normalization, upon fixed points, and all these phenomena which I've been studying. Now, I became acquainted with those people very rapidly, and in short time established a very close working relation with several of them. So my work in physics can be described in two parts. When I was working alone, solo, on these questions which are of part of physics, but you could say physics but not physics proper. In a sense, it's physics of a kind which was carried on by people who did not call themselves physicists. Some were called fluid mechanics experts, others were electronics experts or hydrologists. Each dealt with a physical phenomenon, but physicists did not have an interest in them, whereas critical phenomena were very much part of physics proper.